everybody. Welcome. We'll see if we get any viewers on here. And let me share this link again really quick. I'm talking to Aeson Knight today. I hope I pronounced that correctly.
You did. So,
okay, good. And I'm very excited because he's a longtime reader, an ordained minister in the Unitarian Church, right?
Right.
Master psychic, Reiki master, been doing wonderful work for a really long time.
Yeah, I have, and I've been really enjoying it for a long, long time, and, you know, really having fun, helping my clients grow and build on, you know, what they really want to bring into their life, and also getting people through those storms, because a lot of people don't talk about those life, growing storms that we have in life. You know, and it's like, okay, this is what you got to do. This is, you know, here's an example. You know, a relationship falls apart because of the communicational style, but it's learning that it's not you, it may not be you miscommunicating with them, it's you learning to meet that style and getting through that storm to understand that. And that's what I see my job being, is being kind of the GPS that says, okay, this is what you want to do. You want to go up, turn left, take a right, and then be set for it.
Totally.
You know, so I get to have fun. I get to watch soap operas all day called, you know, People's Lives, because, you know, I'm a natural clairvoyant that's got some training. I do use the tarot to kind of connect with myself and, you know, connect with the client's energy. So we get to, you know, I get to have fun. I get to, you know, look at interesting people's lives, because everybody, you know, whether it's a housewife to a government official, you know, your life's interesting to me. So I get to kind of be the people watcher.
Right, exactly. And then, like you said, you mentioned a little bit earlier, people bring us their deepest, darkest secrets that they can't really express to anybody else. So they hold us in really high regard.
They do, but that means that we also have to hold ourselves in that high regard. You know, people's confidence, you know, you don't go, you know, when we're in that confidence, we don't go and share things. And, you know, with me in person, you know, and, you know, when I'm doing readings, as soon as the reading's done, I forget the information. Of course, you know, I do good to remember my password to log on. But, you know, the guide takes the file, puts it away, and it's like, okay, who's next?
Right. And do you feel that helps you kind of get a better connection with people, no matter when they talk to you, no matter what their life is going through?
It does, because, you know, I'm not walking in there going, okay, we talked to Susie last week, and Susie was having problems with Mike, and Mike was being a ditz, so when we talk to Susie now, well, Mike's still being a ditz, right?
Right.
It's like, you know, I don't have that back information to make judgment, because, guys, let's be real. Our lives can change on a dime, less than 2 minutes, and a 30-year relationship can be over. You can be moved on and dating another guy, and you can be in a different place of living.
Right, so totally.
It does me no good to keep notes, because it doesn't apply. It's not like, you know, it would be like, you know, a GPS going, well, you went 20 miles in an hour 10 minutes ago, so you need to go 13 miles an hour now. Doesn't work.
Right.
It's never worked with my gift. It never works with my guides. They don't like, you know, they like being able to go get me what I need for my client.
In the moment.
In the moment. In that second, where their life is at. And what choices they're facing at making, because that's something else I think people get confused, is they think that I get to tell people what to do all day. No, I just get to present you the options. It's you making the choices to, you know, do this work or go, this one ain't worth it. I'm going to move on to the next one you were talking about.
And I love the way that you put that too, because so many people come to us and unfortunately they want us to tell them what to do. Tell me what to do. Should I leave him? Should I stay? And that's a huge responsibility to lay on somebody that's not in charge, you know, who's not going to live the outcome of that.
Right. And, you know, not only that, but it's not our place. It would be like, you know, because when we're tapping into that ethereal energy, the Akashic Records, whatever marketing title you want to throw onto it, you know, all it is okay, you've got to take English. It doesn't say that you have to do great at it. You have to take math and you have to go through this social experiment. And, you know, what you do in those classes, whether you take a quiz or you do the test or, you know, you date John or you date Sue, that's your choice.
Right.
And, you know, that's your outcome that you get to enjoy. So I don't give people permission. I really don't. I give them information. They have to make their own choices. And I find a lot of people are just looking for permission. And it's like, not my job. You have to give yourself permission.
Right. Right. Definitely. Well, and sometimes what we come up with only serves to verify what they already know.
Right. You know, and, you know, a lot of times what comes out and they're like, oh, I knew that he was doing that. Or, oh, you know, I knew that he had this or he, you know, this was going on. And I'm like, okay, that makes sure that I'm on check. You know, you're seeing a sign that says Bowling Green. But, you know, this is where the next intersection looks like.
Right.
Or this right. is, you know, what's going on. And then I find that a lot, you know, and then also I find that I have to give people tools, or I give people tools to work out stuff, to work out the garbage, because in today's society, today's world, people, I say people read Cinderella to their children too much. And the reason for that, and like Beauty and the Beast and that type of thing, because they only read probably chapter one of their life. Well, chapter two says that, you know, Cinderella and Prince Charming have a fight and the evil stepmother moves in and, you know, tries to take over the kingdom. Well, nobody talks about that.
Right. You're so right. I love that because especially in spirituality, I mean, for, you know, the past, whatever, you know, since 10 years, maybe perhaps even longer than that, it's kind of like roll it in glitter and, you know, forget what it is underneath the glitter.
Exactly. I mean, it's like in 87 when they started this whole soulmate and twin flame thing. It's marketing, people. Soulmates, everybody has soulmates. Guess what? We probably have multiple ones. Mm-hmm. Unless you've lived two lives and every time they come back, the same person. It's kind of like, in, you know, when you were in elementary school, there were 30 children in your classroom. Same thing. You know, you may date Johnny in second grade and John in third grade and Mike in fourth grade. Same thing going on in our life. But, you know, in I think it was 87 through 90, the big term was soulmate. Well, people got tired, you know, and they covered it in glitter and remarketed it and repackaged it as, you know, the one and only and this attrition bond. No, you know, that's just like, okay, yeah, we went to high school together. That's about all you get there. And then they moved on to twin flames, and now they've got something called violet flames. And I'm like, really? How many colors can we paint the same term just to sell another book?
Right. Oh, I didn't realize because I always associate the violet flame with like Saint Germain. So I see it in a completely different context than.
Right. But, you know, they're now trying to paint the soulmate slash twin flame as violet flamed mates. Or, you know, and now they're trying to sell a repackage. Same thing they've been repeating since, you know, I think Casey came out with it in 42 in his writings of, you know, souls being connection and having the connection. So, you know, it's like, okay, we're not jumping here. So, you know, a lot of people don't like it that I'll use those fancy terms. But here's the thing. If you're soulmates, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter that you had a class before because you'll have a new class this time.
Right. Oh, that's a really good way of looking at it, too. It's just, you know, you're in the same class.
Yeah.
Again, repeating it. So, yeah.
You know, as long as you don't bring your baggage from the last time, and that happens with cell memory and, you know, secondary life issues. But now people are, you know, still trying to apply things that doesn't apply anymore. Example, I want him to fight for me. What, you want him to go out and kill a dragon?
Right.
You know, it doesn't, you know, we don't have knights in shining armor anymore. They're galloping off to war. You know, people, you know, need to understand that relationships are negotiations, and a lot of times I'm the mediator in that.
Right.
I think people carry too much garbage from one relationship to another. You know, example, first husband cheats on you, second husband cheats on you. the third person you're just dating. Oh, he's going to cheat. Is he cheating on me? No. Don't accuse him of it 40 times and he'll go do it to make you happy.
Right. Right. Exactly.
Yeah. You know, and, you know, over at Psychic World, we've launched a lot of things. We've got blogs up. We're adding this video chat, and they've got phone and, you know, basic chat. So, you know, we're able to really help people that way in different mediums now.
Oh, I agree totally. So it's much more, you know, you can be as anonymous as you want to be with a chat with one of the Psychic World advisors, or you can be just full seeing each other open. Some people really prefer, you know, to hear a voice and see a face and understand, you know, yeah, you're paying attention to me. This is my time.
Mm-hmm. That enables us, as you know, on the psychic side of things, to offer you the service that fits your time. I mean, because I've had customers call me from the closet to talk with me because the boyfriend's downstairs in the living room. But with chat, you can't, you know, he's not going to hear you coming to get advice on how to deal with him or, right, you know, answering the questions you want to hear. That's why I like the chat. The video chat, you know, we're breaking into. It's a new thing. But it's going to be fun. And we'll see how it works out. But that gives you the ability to really look and connect with us. But it also gives us the ability to really, like, show you that, hey, you're going to have to be strong here with the strength card, that type of thing, so that you can get more of that in-person connection with, you know, the readers. And it's literally like you actually get to come to my office, and which a lot of people don't get to do because, you know, I'm international, like Psychic World. We've got clients all over the world. That we're aiding and assisting. And, you know, we've got some good ones. You know, me and you were talking before the show began, and, you know, we were talking about some of the readers and, you know, how a lot of them are, you know, 10 years plus on their stuff. You know, we've actually chosen a lot of elite psychics out there.
Right. And we're working to get more elite psychics within our group, you know, really kind of recruiting the best, brightest stars, so that, you know, we can offer not only, you know, there are people, I believe in giving really good starters a chance, you know, finding out what they can do, but the people who are tried, true, and tested, you know, you have to kind of have a few of those available as well.
Well, yeah, and, you know, and it's the thing, you know, with psychics, yeah, there are some that have been doing it for 30 years, and they will knock you at the door and, you know, be able to read anybody and anyone. And then there are those that are newbies that are, especially now, coming up. I mean, comparisons to when, you know, I was coming up, you know, I learned tarot in the attic with my grandmother, you know, because that was the... You know, she didn't want people to know that she even done tarot. Now Walmart carries tarot. And yes, they do. I've seen it. It's like, really? You know, a totally different world. You know, we're, you know, so, you know, these young ones coming up that have maybe been doing it 2 to 4 years, they're, you know, meeting, if not beating us, because they've gotten all that information, all that training, which I think is highly important. And, you know, we've got to get out there, you know, us older ones need to be trying to pass on to these younger ones, you know, like we've done for centuries, but they're doing really good too. And they're getting that fresh perspective. They're catching things. They catch on to things much faster than a lot of us olders do. You know, the older, more, you know, elite ones, you know, we're used to sitting on the phone listening to the worst elevator music until we hear beep, beep, incoming client. Which is back when I started it, that's how it worked. You know, now it's so great because, you know, you can reach me if I'm at the beach, you can reach me wherever, you know, because we're on mobile, we're, you know, mobile site, mobile use. The most interesting thing is when someone calls me from the car, because it's like, you know, I get a little like, especially if they're going on curvy roads, it's like, what are we doing?
Like, I'm getting a little car sick here. Can you pull over?
Or slow down, please? My goodness.
Right. Well, yeah. And then, you know, You can, I think it's really kind of interesting how we pick up the energy. You know, I was chatting with somebody today and I was just like, I know how you feel because I feel it. You know, I can feel the reaction or you know. And so for empaths and for clairvoyance, yeah, when you're driving down a road and you're mentally, you know, kind of working through things and sorting things out, you're taking your advisor for a ride too.
Right. You know, and you know, in 10 years we'll be sitting in the car beside them in a holograph going, you know, you really should just like turn left here, it'd be quicker.
Right, exactly. So like, is that him? Is that the one you're talking about there?
Yeah. You know, because now, you know, it's like, don't I, you know, I do, you know, honey, you know, and I don't know how, I wish I had a dollar for every time that I've said this. Honey, knock it off. I'm not fighting with you. I'm not him. Don't argue with me.
Right.
You know, because for me, that's when the energy gets resistant and I have to stop the reading. Because if it's getting resistant, you're not listening to me. Like, you ain't listening to him.
Right. Now, how do you feel? This is always something that strikes me as a fun reading. When somebody doesn't tell us the truth, and we see the truth, and we call it out, and they get mad about and it's just like...
You know, it's one of those, you know, they normally not only get mad, but they get past aggravated about it. Because it's like, well, you know, and it's like, no, that ain't how it is. Or, you know, half the time I have to sort it out and go, this ain't adding up. You know, either I'm totally off in this, and I'll own up. If I'm off, I'm sorry, I'm off.
Right.
You know, because some people I don't, or I'll say, this is what I'm getting. And they're like, well, that's not how it is. And I'm like, give it 3 days. The fun readings that I get and are the ones that are what I call the Jerry Springer readings. You know, I'm dating John, Mike, and Sue, and I'm like, Sue, yeah, you know, the mother was a hippie and, you know, called him, okay, fine. You know, those are the ones I like. I like those multiple interactional activated people that actually are out there and exploring and checking options. And it gets interesting. It gets fun. To help and see them grow, because you'll find that eventually they all either go away because they were just mini chapters of your class, or you start seeing the same issue, so it's the lesson, and then they get through that lesson and they go down to the one they really want.
Right.
You know?
Well, and it's really interesting that you bring that up, because also, you know, so many of us are non-judgmental. We roll with it when somebody brings us, you know, these interesting, really, they're bringing us their life lessons. They're like, I'm living, I'm exploring, and I'm a little confused right now.
Right. You know? Or, you know, different types of relationships. I mean, let's be honest, this is, you know, 2000s, you know, we're almost into the second decade of the 2000s. Relationships aren't 1 + 1 and, you know, only Mike and Jeff, and, you know, we're back in the Victorian 1900s again, where, you know, you have to be escorted throughout every date and you never get to be alone with the person. I mean, relationships nowadays may be 2 people dating, 4 people dating each other. I mean, the box is open, and you know, for what? And it really was already up until about 1850s is when that sterilized Victorian, you know, idea of relationships started coming about and being pushed there of, you know, 1 + 1 and all that. You know, like right now I'm co-working on a book called The Rules of Being a Mistress. Because, you know, there is that status of being a mistress. I mean, the French, it's been part of their lifestyle for centuries. But, you know, and that happens, especially if you're like an overachiever on your life schedule. And, you know, you go through, you know, all this and you go through hellacious time because you're maxing it out. And then you get to the point and you meet, you know, David, but David's still married to Susan and they've got 3 kids. And you start having a relationship with him because you're early. you know, you weren't supposed to be there maybe a year later when the divorce happens. And that can be difficult.
Right. Right. But then I also, you know, you get, we usually talk to the mistresses, which is really interesting.
Right.
Usually not the wives.
I get them both.
Okay.
Okay. Which is difficult because with the wives, it's like, okay, this is where you're headed. Just kind of start putting the cookie jar money away and having your life ready because yes, he is cheating and you need to go on. Or I get the mistresses going, it's Christmas. Why hasn't he came over? It's Christmas. You get Boxing Day.
Right. Right.
He gets Christmas. That's part of the deal here. You know, and like I said, it can be an emotional turmoil, especially if they're in that ideological one-on-one, you know, no married people idea, and then they fall in love with someone that's married.
Right.
Or I get the spouse slash boyfriend, girlfriend that is feeling so much guilt. And it's like, no need to be guilty. This happens. This is life.
Right. Right. And then, you know, it's a point where you know, we're honest with them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in those situations, usually I ask them to be honest with themselves. Number one, is this where you want to be in 5 years? Is this the kind mm-hmm. of relationship you see yourself wanting to maintain and go forward in? Because there are people who are fine with it.
Yeah.
And like you said, you just have to get over that Victorian programming.
Yeah, the Victorian programming of, you know, oh, I have to divorce. Do you? Is that where you want to be? Is that what you want? Or, you know, can you make this work? I mean, I know many people that are in secondary relationships and have been for years. Everybody's happy. Everybody, you know, knows that, you know, oh, he goes bowling on Tuesdays and Thursdays. He ain't bowl. That boy can't bowl worth nothing. He goes over and sees Mike or Susie or whoever on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And it functions. Guess what? It functioned before we started this big pandemic of, you know, boxing in what a relationship is.
Right.
And squaring it off.
Right. And, you know, you bring up a really good point, too. You brought it up a little bit earlier about that. I want him to fight for me. I want everything to be this Hollywood Cinderella, you know, he loves me. He always shows me his love. And, you know, and then when the troubles start coming, which is normal, you know, then no, because normal life is happening to them.
Right. And, you know, people don't realize, you know, that people get, you know, even in normal relationships, you know, standard relationships, you're not going to throw out, you know, the bells and whistles every minute of the day, because then it stops being special. And a lot of men get that, you know, get to that point in a relationship, and women get confused because they normally tire out, you know, men normally tire out before the women of getting the flowers and the candy every Friday and, you know, the I love you 40 times a day. And social media's just aggravated that. Because they'll go, why hasn't he called me? Well, didn't he like your post on Facebook? Hasn't he been posting all over Facebook? Haven't you been commenting on everything he said on Facebook? Well, yeah, but that's not a call. He's been communicating with you in his mind.
Right, right.
You know.
Well, and that brings up the comparison, too, which makes it even worse for everybody, you know. Oh, mm-hmm. you know, and I've fallen into this trap myself. Like, oh, my gosh, that person's husband is away all the time, and they get a call every day. And then I think about it, and I'm just like, we're just not like that, you know. Should I compare myself to their normal? Because why? Because it's on social media, you know.
Or, you know, for me, you know, being on the reflective side of that, of being in a relationship, you know, I go on a trip and I'm like, thank goodness I'm gone. And he's like, thank God he's out of the house. I can do this, this, and this. Right. Because, you know, my partner works as my assistant. So we are together 24/7, sometimes even 24/76, because we work in tandem. So when we're apart, we love that idea. It's like, I ain't calling you until I'm on the plane headed home. Great. Goodbye. I've got gaming to go do, and I'm going to go do this. Okay, fine. But, you know, we get in that little tangent of you know, keeping up with the Joneses. Well, you know, Joan gets flowers every Thursday. Yeah, but you get a new car every year that he brings you on your birthday. You know, which do you want, a car or flowers? You can't compare them because they're not the same. It's like looking at companies, which I like doing but don't get to do much. No company runs the same. No industry runs the same. No CEO is the same. You know, so you have to get that. You have to stop that on social. You know, you see it and like, oh, that's cute. But then look and see what your partner provides you. Example, mine makes sure I don't wake up without coffee. One for his sanity and one for my sanity.
Sorry, speaking of drinks. But that's awesome. See, and I'm sure that, you know, it's the little things like that that you appreciate. And perhaps he's not doing something that somebody else's partner is doing, but still you're getting your coffee every morning. Can you talk to my husband about that, the whole coffee in bed thing?
Oh, yeah. You know, I can explain to him very quickly that, you know, coffee means an easy morning that you don't have to sit and have that morning argument as you're trying to rush out the door to go to work, or, you know, to go get onto the stream so you can do your gaming or whatever. Coffee makes it easier for you to do that because she's going to take 5 minutes for herself and not jump into your day that you've trying to figure out.
My husband doesn't talk in anything except monosyllabic grunts before 10 a.m. Uh-huh. But I also like another thing that you said. People these days, when they're in relationships, they expect to be stuck together like glue. You know, no breathing room, no space, no time. You know, no individual likes, you know.
Well, not only that, but they get into this pattern of, they forgot the old rule of, if he don't call by Wednesday, I'm going to wash my hair on Friday nights. They want a Netflix and chill every night. And that kills the beginning stream of a relationship.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. And they say opposites attract, and there's a reason for that, because they say opposite. You know, an example of that, you know, and I'll take my relationship for an example. He's a gamer. He does the video game. He does the video streams. He's all into this gaming stuff. Not me. I'm like, okay, whatever. I, you know, will watch it and find it fascinating that he can spend 3 hours slapping this imaginary animal. You know, for me, I'm more the let's go write a book type thing on why you're doing this. But that's a good thing because I can't, you know, get into that. But I'm sitting around talking to six other people in my head that nobody else can hear. Finding those things that we fell in love with the person for, it's highly important to remember them.
Right. Especially the farther along you get into your relationship.
So. Yeah. You know, because as you get into that longer relationship, things start getting intermeshed more and more and more. I mean, you know, he wasn't always my assistant. Now he'll look at me and go, so where are the planets today, Mr. Crab? And I'm like, you didn't even know astrology before we got together. What are you doing comparing me to a Cancer?
Right. Right.
You know, so we start blending off onto each other. And it's even been noted by science that couples that have been together for more than 20 years have the same friends normally, which I don't think is good. And now with social media, we're all intermeshed with everybody, and the relationship breakup divorces and, you know, friend negotiate divorces are even harder. So, of course, this also involves a lot more stalking behavior. If you have you noticed that, you know, oh, I saw on Facebook that he liked Sherry's picture of a dog. Is he dating Sherry? It's like, oh, please, really? He liked a freaking picture. Men don't think that way. They've not caught up to that. Of, ooh, right. I can't do that because, you know, I can't, you know, in the old days, I can't go have lunch with Susan because Joan will think that I'm dating her, just having a business lunch. Men's brains haven't gotten programmed to that point. Women, however, are already FBIing it.
Right. Well, women, yeah, men and women are totally different people. Right. And you bring up another important thing that's like that trust thing, even if you are having lunch with Susan and Joan knows that, Joan has to say, you know what? If Aeson wants to go have lunch with her, it's cool.
Right. Because nothing's going to happen. But see, you have to have that foundational trust that's already been laid in there.
Right.
And we don't do that anymore because we're somebody snap, let's speed through this. We've been dating for 6 weeks, so we're on everybody's social networks. We've already, you know, he's already, tweeting with my mother. No, we're skipping those foundational steps of building that relationship. And that's when you have those baggage issues come back in because, you know, you speeded through and you didn't lay down that negotiational plane of, okay, this is okay and that is okay, but this and this isn't okay.
Right. But also it's a thing about, you know, probably jumping from one relationship into the next. You know, there's that whole, okay, I'm done with this guy and I met this guy, so I'm going to kind of migrate over here without like taking any kind of break in between, not even figuring out who you are. Not, you know, if he's been, you know, doing whatever and you know, not earning the trust, being a bad, not treating you with respect or whatever. And then you don't get over it. And this is what you were talking about earlier. You bring that baggage from him into this relationship because you never settled it. You never just cut it, figured yourself out, taking yourself to the next level. And then,
Well, let me tell you how I learned this lesson. My previous life, I was living in North Carolina. I got a job in Columbus. So I moved to Columbus. I had movers pack my stuff, zip me up there because I was already working when I got there. And then 3 weeks later, my dad gets sick. So I had to move back to West Virginia, bring the new job with me, come back to West Virginia. Well, guess what? The movers came to Columbus, packed up my stuff, brought it down to back to West Virginia. So I've moved back to West Virginia, made two moves in less than 3 months.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Hadn't gotten most things unpacked. Well, guess what? As I'm going through and opening up boxes and going, okay, we don't need 4 coffee pots. We need 10. We don't need this. We need that. They had packed up the garbage in a box. They had packed the trash cans that had the kitchen garbage in it. They had packed up everything. Because I just told the movers, pack everything up, bring it up here. It was one of those circumstances where I didn't plan the move. I just done the move. That's what we're doing in relationships. We're moving boxes. We're moving the kitchen trash from one relationship to the next relationship to the next relationship without taking and going, oh, well, I don't need this anymore. Let's throw it away. And then we start trying to turn the new person into the old person that didn't work.
Right.
You know,
exactly.
It'd be like, you know, starting to dress your husband in an old boyfriend's clothes. Doesn't work. He's going to rebel and blow off.
Right. Wow. So I'm just all like taking this in. It's really good because
it is.
It's what we have to talk a lot about with, you know, a lot of times with my clients, I'm either talking about making time for yourself, especially when I talk to women and men too. Men need to take time for themselves. They can't just be working at work, working at home, going to bed, doing it all again.
That's why I think everybody should have a gym membership. I think probably the most toxic things for marriages is they go from work to home. Straight work to home. The reason is you bring that stress and that aggravation of wanting to kill your boss at work, home, and then have the fight with the wife, the argument with the teenager, and screaming at the 4-year-old.
Yep.
You know, that's why I like the British culture of, you know, you go to work, you may come home for tea, you may not, and then you go to the pub for a little bit, and then you come back and spend family time.
Oh, see, that would be nice.
That type of, you know, that's having that space, because people forget the relationships aren't making a circle. It's putting two squares side to side each other.
Right.
You know, You can't morph into one person. You have to still be two. And you have to have that, you know, this is mine. And that's yours. You know, this is my gym membership. I go 3 times a week. That's your new video game. You go play that for how many hours you want.
Right. Yep. Oh, exactly. Maintaining your own, you know, your own social network is really mm-hmm. important. Like you were saying, we're getting way too meshed, mm-hmm. you know, with the mutual friends and the, you know, and everything like that. Well, you know, some mutual friends is good. And of course, you're going to probably know all your partner's friends. After, you know, my husband and I have been together for 10 years now. We pretty much know each other's friends.
Right. And you always have the ones that you don't like, but they do. And that's perfectly fine. Go have lunch with them.
Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. And also allow your partner to maintain friendships with the people of the other sex or the you know, the that they can get that perspective of why in the heck is my wife freaking out on me? You know, he can go and talk to his friends about it and just be like, oh, they'll be like, she's a girl. What did you do? You know?
Right. And, you know, and I think that's highly important. I think that letting that jealousy monster of, oh, you know, all he has is female friends, they'd be in trouble with me because, you know, the industries I've worked in has been 95% female orientated, 95% female set up. Most of the women I get, most people I get along with are women. I actually, you know, very few men in my life. But it's like, you know, what do you mean he had, you know, why are you throwing a fit over who he's friends with? If anything, she's saving you from having to explain. When you do not call after 2 hours of being out, then she begins to worry that you're in a ditch.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they can actually, you know, when you have people of the opposite or same sex or, you know, however the biorhythm is, as you, that you want them in your life because they're going to cut through the crap. They can look at him and go, you're being a dick, and I suggest you send her flowers tomorrow or your ass is going to be in the sling. And no, you can't sleep on my couch because you are a dick.
Right, exactly. Yeah, it's
you know, true. Find your allies within his friend network as you're introduced to them. Don't go seeking them out. You know, right. When you're introduced to them, find your allies. Realize that people are package deals. You can't cut off the baby mama because the baby mama's kicked into the child that you're, if you continue this, you're going to be the stepmom too. So you need to get to know that package deal after 6 months.
Right.
I think it's highly important that, you know, anybody that's coming in with package deals, the first two negotiation partners, you and him or her, however it is, take 6 months just to date.
Right.
Before right. you start intermeshing the children. And then, if you have to, the baby's mamas. But the baby mamas or the baby daddies aren't your responsibility. It's like you're their car payment aren't your responsibility. You ain't going to pay his car payment when you're just dating right. him. Don't be worrying about the baby mama.
Right. Or see how he treats her. Understand well, that might be how you get treated in a few years, too.
In a few years, too. But, you know, that doesn't mean that, you know, she's wanting to be back with him. Because guess what? If she wanted to be back with him, she already would have. You wouldn't be on the market with him.
Right.
You know, I think a lot of people get trapped up into that. Oh, you know, he was with her before. Is he still with her? No, he's trying to teach the kid how to play baseball.
Yep. Because most of the time when it comes to... Well, I won't say. I'll keep my own personal stuff out of here. But, yeah, you're totally right about it, too. It's just, you know, you don't have to automatically have an attitude toward the other people in your new romantic interest's life.
Right. You know, and you shouldn't because you're not dating the baby mama or the mother or the cousin that lives with him all the time's house. You're dating him. You need to get to know him first before, you know, you figure out if you even want to deal with the baby mom, because you may not want to. Have a lot of people that are in that situation and they won't even answer the phone for the baby mama or whatever. They'll hand the phone to the party that's responsible for it.
Right.
You know. And then, you know, a lot of the other things I cover career, I cover work. I love looking at people's careers and how they're advancing or how, you know, they need to take it in a new direction because a lot of industry is changing, not only ours, but everywhere else. You know, I think in 10 years, we're going to see a lot less offices. You know, we're going to go back to, you know, everybody having their own little compartmental thing, which is going to change how we interact as a society.
Well, and I'm not sure how I like that so much right now. I'm kind of working my way into that one because, you know, you do live in-person readings as well.
Right.
And sometimes just being, I really feel like people need social connection. I really feel like they need, you know, kind of symbiotic, you know, being with other people kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I like that. You know, for us as psychics, I tend to be in a lot of chat rooms, you know, to get that water cooler conversation going on. Facebook fills in a lot of that social time, but that also gives us the ability to start building those friendships and those, you know, black book list of connections of, oh, there's a new network open. Okay, guys, there's a new network open. I'm going to work it for a month and I'll tell you what I think. And then if I think it's good, I'll bring you over. And that's how, you know, us as an industry has started building on that. Other industries will figure out their own thing. I'm seeing a lot of growth on LinkedIn of, you know, people starting to build that connection and that network, and a lot of home workers starting to join up and build to group there. But I think that, you know, as we traverse, you know, as like big companies like Ford and all these others start moving from those huge complexes to really just having a conference center that you run in to have a meeting at, with a client that you can't telescope from, we're going to start seeing a new revival to the social society starting to build back up and the guilds and stuff like that, like we had in the late 17th and 18th century when you had kind of like these vacuum groups that were interconnected. You know, example, and the leftovers of that is like the Lions Club and the Masonic Lodges and the Radulus Club or whatever. You're going to start seeing that occur again. You know, we're starting to see hiking groups and yoga groups and people getting into activities more because they no longer have to go, oh, it's 8 o'clock, I got to be at work in 45 minutes, and then I got to come home and get something to eat and then, you know, do the evening things. You know, I think we're going to move to a world that, you know, you can naturally, you know, oh, it's 10 o'clock, I've got to go log into the office. Oh, it's 2, I'm logging out. I'm going to go to Johnny's baseball game, and then I've got to go to Susie's play. And then, oh, they're in bed, it's midnight. Well, I'm going to go and, you know, I'm going to log in and deal with my customer in China. Or, you know, answer those emails. I think we're going to get into that where we can get out of that 9-to-5 biorhythm that really wasn't set into place until the mid-40s.
Right.
And I'm also think that we're going to start seeing a growth of a lot more freelancers. And we're already seeing that with networks like this, places like Fiverr, freelancer.org. A lot of freelancers are starting to pop up there. And I think we're going to start seeing a lot of that, which is great because that means that a lot of people don't have to be connected to their jobs. They don't have to live in a specific place that may not be ingrained for them to be there to do their job. And, right. You know, it's going to change the economy a lot because, you know, we're already starting to see the changes occur, you know, with some of the things coming out. I mean, come on, you know, 2017's cars have built-in Wi-Fi. Really? What is it that you need to do with built-in Wi-Fi while driving?
No, it's not for you. It's for the kids in the back who are playing Minecraft and they can't get on the internet. Seriously. Or your wife who's trying to hook up the Spotify so you can listen to some good music.
Right.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think we're going to start seeing a lot more of that stuff so that you can be flexible on that 6-hour drive. You can actually be in the office.
Right.
I can remember 5 years ago taking a conference call on a cell, a phone bag, while driving home from a conference. So I do like that. I like the ability that, you know, we're going to become into a more free society. But I think that we're going to start seeing that a lot of that in industry. I think we're going to start seeing people breaking that rat race.
Right. Well, and I think it's really helping people like you and me. I think it's helping to give us more time and energy. And like you were saying, the knowledge that's there right now is just amazing. It's just fabulous. You can look up any plant. You can look up any spell. You can look up any recipe or remedy or, you know, folkloric, you know, kind of anything. And you have it at your fingertips. And when you and I were growing up,
oh, dear goodness, you know, we didn't have it. We literally, it was like, you know, what? You know, the closest we could, if you did not have, you know, the blessed grandmother or the blessed cunning friend around, then you were like SOL. I mean, you know, you got to think, you know, you brought up spells and stuff, and I kind of want to touch on that a little bit. No spell costs $300 to cast.
Thank you.
Freaking no candle spell costs $500 to cash, $1,000 to cash. That is baloney. Don't come to me, though, and ask for a spell, because I'll tell you, go do your own research. Because here's the thing. Controlling your environment is your responsibility, not mine. I am not there to control your world. And I know a lot of scam artists, and I call them scam artists point blank, will go, oh, give me $1,000 and I can cast the spell to bring it back to you. Bullshit. There's no easy fixes when you've, you know, hacked the man's door down with an axe and threatened to kill him. He is not going to come back to you, no matter how many spells you get done. And another thing that drives me nuts, and it'll drive me crazy, and it's when these carnies, and yeah, they're carnies, they're not psychics, they're not advisors, go, oh, there's this dark energy around you, and you need to take, I need to work for you to take it off. Give me this amount of money to do it.
Right. No.
Bull crap.
Well, and that's one thing at Psychic World, I have to do QA. I'll tell you, I do QA. And I'm lucky like you, my guides say, okay, you're seeing this, you need to see it for this amount of time, but the information just goes whoop right out after I see it. But, you know, there are some people who say the same exact thing to every person. And I say, bye-bye, see you later, because I'm not going to, oh, I see some negativity around you. I feel like you're confused.
Right.
Really? This person is talking to a psychic. You don't, you know, they just called you because they're happy and they want to share their cake recipe with you, you know?
Right. And, you know, those old lines just drive me. I do QA. That's my style of reading. I don't do general because, really, do you need to hear? And this is how, you know, my guides literally start out every general reading. Well, they aren't sleeping. I haven't seen them out in the sunlight in forever, and it looks to me here they don't drink water. You guys already know that. You may already know that, you know, he'll be home at 6 o'clock. You know, my in-person meetings take about 45 minutes to an hour because I do start out with a general with them. That's going to be costly on any network, so I don't do general readings. But the comment about, oh, I see negative energy around you, really? Go take a shower. And, you know, or this, oh, you've got a curse that a third gypsy's cousin put on you from, you know, blah, 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 and your whole family's curse. No. Please. Right. First of all, I want to state this again. Who did your third gypsy's cousin's fourth removed son, whatever, piss off so much that they spent their whole life cursing you and then continue to do it in the afterworld? That ain't going to work, first of all. That, you know, metaphysically does not work. And secondly, it's crap. And if you want to break a curse, it's real easy to go do. Go piss on a red brick and throw it out your left window. Okay? You know, if you're all that, oh, I'm cursed, you know, I've pissed someone off so bad they're cursing me. Do that and be done with it. You know, because it only works if you're putting the energy into it.
Thank you. Because that's another thing, like, they feed the fear. It's just like that euphemism or the little story about the Indian talking to his grandpa about the wolves. And there's a wolf that's fed off, or like there's a wolf that eats only sadness and fear and sorrow and everything like that, and another wolf that only eats happiness and whatever, love and kindness and generosity. And the grandson asks the grandfather, oh, which one lives? And the one that you feed. You know, if you feed the fears,
mm-hmm. they're going to grow. Then,
yeah. And yeah. yeah.
You know, and that's even been proven with that scientific experiment of water. If you take water and you have water that you sit there and you just splurt obscenities and curse words at and negativity at, it's going to affect itself. It's going to change molecularly. If you have water, you only speak good and happiness, it's going to change molecularly. But what we don't look at is how we are treating ourselves. And if we're going, oh, I'm cursed, I'm never going to find love, I'm going to be alone always, I ain't good enough at this, I suck at that, I don't like people, then we're always going to be that way. But when we start taking and valuing ourselves and seeing our value and demanding our value and being kind to ourselves and taking that 5 minutes to listen to your favorite song and while doing something else, or you know, building your schedule into your life so that it's more easier for you to be, then you're not going to have that negativity spewing out of you like fog for people to just, what I call, surface read, which is, you know, basically, oh, you know, I'm just going to look at the cover of the book and see what the book's about. You can't do that.
Right. Well, and unfortunately, a lot of times if they're picking up that external negativity that you're radiating, you don't want to be with those people long term anyway.
Right. You know, and you don't. And in general, you don't want to be with those people long term. And you don't want to deal with that long term. And if you're radiating that negativity, and I've had it happen twice in almost 26 years of reading, when I've looked at someone and said, you need to go take a shower, I feel like everything around you is just drum, depressed, and negative. And it turned out both of them were bipolar depressives and had stopped taking their medications.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So it was a biochemical thing. But I've never, ever seen someone curse that, you know, it takes $1,000 to get rid of a curse. It takes you taking a hot shower with a salt to get rid of anything, because it makes holy water. Boom, done, right. Over, done with. And and everybody knows that.
Well, and you're a Reiki master too. So most of, you know, what we learn is how to, like, you know, just get that energy. And I'm sure that you were probably doing energy work before you were attuned to Reiki. And it's just
and it was real interesting when I was taking my Reiki training and I was doing the, you know, because we had to do so many practicals and, you know, it was a full active 4-day course. I'm going, ooh, you've got problems with your knee here. Oh, I can see that. Let's move this tendon this way. And they're like, ooh, I can feel that. And I said, I know. I'm sitting here using this because clairvoyantly I could go into the body, see where it's at, and move it. And my instructor at the time said, you're not doing Reiki. You're doing something else. I don't know what it is, but you're doing something else. This is how you do Reiki. You take and you circle. I'm like, okay, well, let me move this tendon back in place. Okay, now I'll circle it with energy.
That's how I, you know, it's just like, you know, when you get attuned to Reiki, and I've said this before, you know, sometimes you're like, it's almost this.
Yeah.
You know, but what I'm doing is different.
Right. And I felt that because I'm also, you know, I'm also into claiming, that's, you know, moving energy too.
Okay.
It's a different modality. It's more based on Cherokee beliefs. So, you know, I've looked at like Hands of Light and everything else. And I have to snap myself into that way, that energy of, okay, you only, you know, if you're doing a Reiki treatment, you're only doing a Reiki treatment. Don't go moving things. Don't go, you know, using it, blowing out this or changing this. Don't do that. Okay, you're in Kalami, so you're going to stir this energy up and you're going to structure this. Or, you know, if you're doing hands-on healing, which is what I prefer to do if I'm working in the healing modality, I can go in there and do Reiki, Kalami, healing, and psychic energy, and just boom, 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 done. You know, so for me, it's really hard to just stick to that. It's like I'll get client, and this happens with clients too. Clients, I just want the tarot. Okay, I can do the tarot. you know, no problem. If you don't want the psychic side of it, I can just do the tarot for you. Here's the physical side of the tarot. And it's like, you know, I can see this. And yeah, you know, we've got the Hermit card here, but it isn't talking about this. It's talking about you needed to cut out this, this, and this. You know, and it's like, oh, I can't. And I can't, you know, literally say that to them because it doesn't fit within their definition of what the Hermit is.
Right.
You know.
But, yeah. And that's the whole thing. Like, why slap a label on it? Why, you know, I understand when I got my Reiki attunement, it did something. It changed the nature of what I was, it changed things, you know.
Oh, it changed a lot for me. You know, that energy, it took me like 3 months to figure out how to, you know, to be able to smell the smell of bacon, and I love bacon.
Right.
Right.
Well, yeah, you can't walk through a crowd. You know, the first couple of days after your attunement, you're like, whoa, this is just way too much. Put me in a field somewhere, you know, protect me from my thoughts and don't let any wildlife near me because I'm just too raw for that. I'm just too open and But I agree with you. Like, there's no, trying to slap a label on it in order. Oh, that's a second cat. I saw the white one earlier. So.
Yeah, this is my office kitty.
Aw.
Yeah. But, you know, you can't, you know, when you limit people, you know, if you don't understand something, you know, one of their, you know, what I call one of my pretty pictures on the wall, I'll be happy to explain them to you. But, you know, with readings, it's really hard for me to section things out. And for me, the only thing that I can't do is I can't get dead people to answer the phone. I couldn't tell you your grandmother's cookie recipe if it, you know, caused me to think about it. Because she ain't going to answer my phone. I'm not a medium. And that's what I like about Psychic World is we've got a mixture of everybody. I mean, you know, we've got highly trained English mediums. I can look at, you know, how their profile is presented and stuff, and I can see where they're coming out of Southern Florida training, spiritualist community, trained mediums. I think we have a voodooist. Am I correct?
Yeah. Yeah. Prince Tai is a voodoo priest. So, yeah.
You know, we've got voodooists. So if that's your flavor, you know, we've got me that's a root worker, but I don't offer that, unless it's like, okay, this is what you really need to do to go fix this. We've got tarot readers. We've got clairvoyance. We have clairaudience. We've got angel readers and angel healers, which, good gracious, for them, and I've always found this interesting when they're connected to the angelic energy. If you've ever watched, their profile has a little bit of an extra glow to it. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
Like their profile pics. You know, it's a stock photo, but you can see that extra energy behind them. And I always thought that that's the only thing that I've seen reflective back in photos is when someone's got that, is an angelic reader. They've got that angel energy behind them.
Right. Well, that's really, it's really cool. And, you know, just going into, like, just thinking about going into videos and everything and being able to, like, look at people's auras and stuff like that is amazing. Like, seriously, you can be sitting there, you're in where, West Virginia, and I'm in Austria, and I could probably do, you know, a nice good aura reading for you sitting here. But like you're saying, there's such a, I mean, I'm sorry, I went off on a tangent there because I was like,
no, it's right. But it also brings back, it allows us to do some of the dying art, tea leaf reading. We can now do tea leaf readings because, you know, you can hold the cup up to the camera. You can see the client's cup and you go, okay, move it a little left, move it a little right. Palm readings that were dying out, you can now do those because you have the video where you can get up in there and see those deep lines. You may not be able to get into where the Mount of Venus is or that type of thing, but you can do that. It, you know, with the video edition, it's going to open up a lot of the older arts that we can't exactly do over the phone. We can't exactly do, through a chat base, because that's what Psychic World's first base was chat. You know, so we're always going to have chat there for those private conversations. But it does allow us as advisors to be able to bring back some of those older arts that aren't there, and some of the newer arts. I mean, there's a lady in Chicago that's reading coffee and how the creamer pours into the coffee for the psychics. So that's scrying. For the old classification, it's a type of scrying. So we're going to be able, you know, with that, it allows us as advisors to offer them more services, or readings, even seeing people's environmental stuff. I mean, because that happens a lot with me, is it's like, ooh, you need to like clean your house because it looks like the reason that you aren't getting booty in the bedroom is your house is so crappy they don't feel comfortable.
Right. Well, yeah. And then, yeah, the material clutter, you know.
Right. Holds energy.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's going to, you know, medical intuitives, which you got to kind of be careful with, but medical intuitives are now going to be able to look at things like skin tone, skin color, different things to help them interpret things. You know, so a client looking for something, looking for a medical intuitive, you know, I'm not classified as a medical intuitive. I have done health. I do a little bit of health. If I get it, if I don't, I won't. But they're going to be able to get more information for you. And you're going to be able to see that we're real. We're not some model package. You know, we went, you know, and I see this on so many other, I see it on a lot of slave networks. And it is model package pictures or model packaged profiles. And, you know, it may be Joan 7-3 advisor visionary. And this month it's really Susan. And the next month it's Johnny filling in. And, you know, they can just flip the pictures around. And, you know, you're not going to get that on Psychic World. We're going to be real, you know, we're real people. And for the advisors out there watching, they treat you really well.
Yeah. So that's one of the things I like about Psychic World. It's okay. First of all, like you said, it's going to open a portal for a lot of different readings. And like you said, you can pick up the energy of the people that you're looking at just by looking sometimes at their picture, their profile picture. But yeah, you want to make sure you're looking at the person. I want to see, are you Aeson? Yeah, I don't want a profile picture that's just a stock picture, you know.
Right. Or a model package that the company has bought and, you know, flips through every 3 years.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. And
somebody has a question.
Awesome.
So if you want to take a question from Simran, she wants to know about her marriage.
Okay.
Do you see that in the room there, or should I tell you? Let's see.
Let me flip over. I can look at it. Yeah. I want to ask about my life. Want to know about my marriage. When will I get married? Okay. So you're wanting to know when you're going to get married. This is more of a timing thing. So you've got to understand that it is a estimate. But let's take a look here. Ooh, okay. All right, so we're looking at you really, you know, having to work and build that because we have the star coming up here, so you're really getting to that guidance level of stuff. And I'm going to say probably looking at with the Seven of Pentacles showing up with tied in with the Ace of Swords, we're looking at about 19 and a half months for that to be coming along. I don't think the person's already there in your life because they're not showing up here. It does show that you're having to be a little bit more stronger with things. So this is, you know, you need to kind of be stretching out there and talking a lot more to people and using more of that mental energy and showing your, I want to use the word vitality with things, okay? And they're going to be the type that's very much into you because we have the Chariot here. And with the Chariot, it really shows that you've got the Princess Diana complex thing going on where you're able to really boost out things and allow things to, you know, they're going to be the type that's always going to be doting on you just like Caesar was to Diana. Oh, and to Cleopatra. Okay, so I hope I answered your question with that.
No, that was really nice. And she says, and life after marriage, which I think you answered really very well, you know, that he's going to be doting on her, that she's going to, you know, feel very looked after.
And just a protective nature. Yeah, very much so. And I would say he probably works in some type of business because I see him in a suit all the time, which, you know, puts me in the mind of either being, yeah, he works in some type of professional business type thing.
Okay.
Okay. So,
I hope that helped you out, Simran. So.
Yeah. And you can always follow up with me on Psychic World, honey, because, you know, I'm sure you're wanting a little bit more detail than that, but this is going to be a live broadcast, and I don't want to go into your interpersonal stuff there.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, because I think that's really important to say to you, Aeson, mm-hmm. that sometimes when we're doing these open mic readings, kind of to right. say it that way, we are going to touch on some painful topics for some people right. or some trigger topics. And mm-hmm. as gentle as we may be with, there's still going to be, you know, one of the things I always advise people is to take a step back and to heal before they jump again right. into another relationship, like I told you about before. But there's right. also things, luckily, when I do my periscopes, and I'm sure when you do your radio show, you run into things where you're just like, maybe we should take this into a little bit of a private
right.
reading.
Exactly. A private thing. And there's some questions that I don't think that the client wants me to answer on air, but I get in private all the time. Because of things going on, because of things in their life that are interpersonal, you know, I wouldn't do that on the inside of things, or, you know, wouldn't put them out there on air for, you know, 2 million people, you know, if it's my radio show, 20 million people to listen to. Really? Do right. you want me to be telling you why you're not getting along with your boyfriend because he stopped hearing you when you started BBBBB? You know, so that things pulls together. You know, so yeah, submit, contact me on Psychic World. I'll be happy to look a little bit more deeper into this, you know, because you've got some things there that we can talk about and I can actually help you get past. Okay? And it'll make this new relationship that you're going to move into a lot better.
Right. And I think, yeah, this is kind of what we were talking about before, just really kind of taking the time to heal.
Right. And to get past things and to close the chapters. You know, because a lot of times we leave chapters open.
And we do it on purpose because, you know, there's always that hope. There's always that,
right.
Maybe he'll come back. Unless you're just like, okay, bye, see you. Don't let it hit you in the butt on the way out. Because
and thank God you're gone. And I've had those in my life. You know, I've had those relationships, marriages, it's like, dear God, they freaking left this morning. Thank the gods. Let's call the dumpster.
Right.
And start, you know, revitalizing yourselves. And, you know, there's steps that we don't get taught. And I think that things like this should be taught in school, of how to move on from relationships, how to refocus on ourselves, self-care, and baggage clean out. They should be taught in, like, I don't know, life economics. They used to teach that. Now I don't think they do anymore.
Right. Well, and books. I mean, there's people like Mama Gina, for example, because, I'm a girl. I'm a woman. Mm-hmm. I have 3 children. I have a husband who's married, and he has a business and everything.
Right.
Or not. He's often away on business. But learning to take care of yourself. Hello, people. You need to learn how to do that. You need to learn how to clear your psyche. You need to learn how to have horrible conversations that you don't want to have because,
Right.
We avoid that. We avoid feeling anymore. We avoid everything, you know, real.
Well, we avoid that, but we also, a lot of it, and I'll put it this way, we don't have the skills a lot of times to have those conversations of, you know, I really just hate your mother. You know, or, you know, I am sick and tired of you being gone every Tuesday, Friday, and Saturday, and me not being able to even take a breath at all because I'm stuck in this house raising your kids all the time. And you know, you need to take, you know, we don't get trained that way. And with the neurological family changes and dynamics, that's where that negotiation and that schedule setting and that, okay, on Thursdays is a mama's day out, you guys are going to school, and then you're going with daddy to daddy's job or daddy to the park, and I'm going to be gone all day. Don't call me. My cell phone will be on the bedside table.
Right, right. And we have to teach women more to do that and less how to cook and clean and look pretty and please their spouse, because they're learning all that. You know, I can apply a lip liner 600 different ways, but to ask my husband for a schedule is way harder, you know? So,
well, you know, and that's when, you know, you have to have those hard conversations of, okay, this is the negotiation. We're all going to use Google Calendar. I've already laid in everything else. And you'll notice the areas in red will be your responsibility. Deal with it. You know, and taking that time of finding that balance with trying to keep everything in order. That's why, you know, I think that we need to be taught planners and how to do a planner. Believe me, it changed my life like 9 years ago, because I used to be into the point of an exhaustion. I mean, just totally wheel me out of the office and throw me onto the bed. And I moved into using a planner system with me being a freelancer and being able to do so much for networks and being able to have a conversation at 3 a.m, not having to worry about my little geo area. I moved into living on a biorhythmic schedule, which works great for me, but I still have things that I have to plan for. And I had, you know, and I think that as humans, not just women, because, you know, we have, you know, now that, you know, within your case, you're the house mom. Within my case, I'm the house overseer. You know, it's my deal, my job to deal with all that stuff. The first thing we have to schedule, and the editor and the owner of Huffington Post just wrote a book on this, is sleep, because we don't get enough of it. Mm-hmm. And we don't get it within our needed area. You know, some people are designed to be up at, you know, 4 a.m, and other people, please, they ain't walking out of bed till at least 11.
Right, right. And to accept that, you know, sometimes we're with partners who are very much different than us on different schedules and everything else. It doesn't mean they don't love us. It just means that they're in bed at different times than we are.
And exactly.
So, yeah.
And, you know, to accept that, you know, example, I'll go on tour starting in April. So there's going to be, you know, I'm going to be very much like your husband and not be home for periods of time. And that's when, you know, that's the negotiation of, okay, since I'm going to be gone, I can take care of A, B, and C. It's your responsibility now to shift over and take care of D, C, and F, and understanding that relationships are fluid. I might not be able to keep our annual Wednesday night date night.
Right.
So let's move it to Thursdays. But that's that where that communication comes in. And it's the communication of being detailed. Because if you're dealing with, and men get stuck in this all the time, they're called active listeners. They're looking for who, what, when, where. Or if you're saying, well, you know, Susie's teacher just sent me a letter about her not performing in English, and the dishwasher broke, and the water blew up, and I had to do this, and I have to go to the grocery store and pick up this, this, and this. Oh, by the way, I need you to take care of the garbage. Do you know what when he stopped listening? Oh, the teacher sent a letter. What's that about? You know, because you're trying that constantly to get that update going on. Then he's not going to reply to you wanting to, you know, reschedule a date night, because he went into Charlie Brown mode. Well, wah, 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 right. Because he's, you know, he's been doing that all day with people throwing text messages and phone calls and office requests and meetings at him, that he goes into womp, womp, womp mode to process what you just said. And I think couples a lot of times get into that. And they get into that, let me decompress on you, or you can't believe the boss in this, and this, and then this client and this, you know, and then they go into that, okay, you're just inventing, let me know when you're done, type energy. And they don't hear that who, what, when, why, when they need to be hearing, I need this, this, and this.
Right.
And when you stop and you look at someone and go, I need this, I need to have a phone line to work in Canada by Thursday. Okay, boom, there you go. You know, he will probably snap up, do that, snap, give it to you and hand it to you, because you told him what you needed, when you needed, and why you needed it.
Right.
A lot of people don't hear that anymore. A lot of, you know, active activity based people. And how you tell if your man is an active based person is he's the type that's going to touch you, kiss you, feel you, hold you, and make sure things are physically done for you. He's not going to be the one, Rhonda, writing you 20 page love emails while he's in Hong Kong on a business trip. That's right. Not an activity he's going to do, but he'll rebuild your closet, which is more valuable, both.
Right. Depending on what you need. And then you need to find, I think that this is another thing too, is that women forget that they have their man for that active, you know, partnership, right, relationship stuff, but they also need women friends or men friends or social network to go out, right, and just, yep, with
chit chat.
And yeah, chit chat, yes, go out, have, right, a drink, have some fun, put the pressure off of your husband or spouse or whatever, and go and we call it blah, you know, just chit chat. Yeah.
Yeah, chit chat, and to decompress, yeah, and go, can you believe he forgot to put the garbage out last week? How dare him? I'm always on top of them. That, and realizing things that you cannot change about your partner. You know, if you've been in it, what, 10 years? I'm going on 5 with this one. Example, I am never going to get him to understand the importance of making sure to feed the cats before he goes out in the mornings to do his errands. Forget it. And, right, and evaluate, is it going to kill you in 20 years? Because here's an example. A man not putting down the seat within the first 3 months of your relationship, if it drives you nuts then, in 30 years, you're going to crack his head against that commode because you've gotten tired of it. You have to, you know, look at those little things and evaluate. Does it change the view of him? Does it change what I need from him? Or does it change his role? And if the answer is no to all this, then guess what? Get up and feed the cats or check the seat before you put it down.
And I want to bring up something you really, sure, said, and that I say to clients a lot of times. Is he doing this now? You've been dating for 2 months and he's doing this now. And it's getting on your nerves. It's only going to get worse as time progresses, because right, mm-hmm, now you're in that, I love you, you're awesome phase. And 5 years from now, you're going to be like, that is so annoying. But is it something you can deal with and accept? Does it make you feel good or bad about yourself? Is it something that you can long term, in the long run?
Well, that, and evaluate. Yeah. I mean, example, what is her name?
That one lady? Oh. No, I'm sorry.
No, I'm trying. Yeah, that one lady. Joan. It's Joan's daughter, Melissa.
Okay, yeah.
The comedian's daughter that died.
Yeah, the one that does the fashion, Joan Rivers. Is that it?
Yeah, Melissa Rivers. Melissa Rivers. Okay. Okay. Her current boyfriend sucks at timekeeping when he's out with his friends. He plays too long. Well, you know, that got on her nerves, and she started taking action of it in the immediate thing. So after 6 months, when he shows up late, he brings her a Louis Vuitton purse because she said, okay, if I'm going to deal with this, then I'm going to get this, which is something, right, I think people forget in negotiations of a relationship. It's like, okay, if you are not going to pick up your underwear, then you get the ability to, then your new job is laundry.
Right. Or, you know, have you've brought it up time and time again. Sandy, I think that Aeson said if you wanted a little bit more information about your situation to go ahead and chat with him online at Psychic World. He'll be on a little bit after we're off tonight. So then we can talk then, or you can talk to Aeson then. So, and it would be a private chat. So, but yeah, that's what you're, you know, negotiate these things. Everything is a negotiation. It doesn't have to be, you don't have to sit and stew in your anger when you could be getting something good about, you know, you can say, okay, if you want to go out with your friends, you know, or if you want to do this, that's fine. That's great. But you need to then do this.
Exactly. You know? And I think that's what, you know, we negotiate with our bosses, which I, mm-hmm, think women should do more. They've got to learn that, you know, you can be the top nurse. Well, guess what? If they don't want to meet your, you know, if you want Fridays off and they can't do it, well, guess what? Hospital B will do it. We need to get that idealism into our relationships too, that it's all negotiation.
Right. And that it's okay. I mean, this is another thing that I run into, and it happens men, women, everybody. And I was talking about this a little bit earlier. You have to learn how to have those tough conversations with your partner. This is going mm-hmm. to be your life partner. And if you can't talk to that person, it's not going to make for a pretty future together.
Right. You know? That may not mean a face-to-face conversation. Nowadays, you don't have to have face-to-face conversations over tough things. A lot of people I see doing negotiations instead of fighting over text message, over a phone call, through an email. Use what works best for them. You know, because if you're coming to the table, you need to figure out what you're going to set the table at. Example, I know this one couple, when they have an issue, one goes into one room, one goes into another, and they both hop onto Yahoo Messenger.
That's a pretty good idea.
So, and they have their argument and their fight and their reconciliation through Yahoo Messenger.
See, I just get my husband drunk.
No, I'm just kidding. May work.
No, but they talk.
They talk through Yahoo Messenger because it causes... He's a writer, so he understands the power of words. It causes him to think more because he's seeing it in text and he remembers it more than her sitting there bantying at him for 2 hours.
Right,
A major issue can be solved in 5 minutes because he's paying attention and understanding the words. That's something you have to figure out with your partner, is what works best for you. Andrew Jackson used to write letters to his wife, and she would write letters back and forth for more than 20 years. They wrote letters back and forth to each other because that's how they were able to get that communication down, share what needed to be shared, air the grievance, and get results.
Right.
And
sorry.
That's okay. Go for it.
I was going to say, and this also works when you're grieving a relationship, when you're really, really angry and upset with your ex, and you just want to get all that crap out, write a letter. You don't have to send it. You can burn it afterwards, but just get it out.
It's better to actually burn it because then you aren't taking your grievances to them and them not really caring.
Right.
Okay. Right. And also, I think people should evaluate the relationship, because here's a weird statistic. For monogamous relationships that have been cheated on, the next relationship does better. And it's really less likely to have a cheat. Yeah, it's a scientific fact. And the reason for that is you do better in that relationship because you see where things are at.
Right. Sorry, I'm messaging Simran here.
Yeah. But no, Simran, you can contact me over at Psychic World. Susan, what's our new benefit for our new people that maybe haven't been to Psychic World?
First 3 minutes are free for new clients. And I don't know if we're running we are not running a special right now, but they can use the... you can invite them, so to say radio, they heard you, okay. Or YouTube.
Yeah, so you can get on YouTube, and you know, we will, you know, you can get, you know, if you're new there, 3 minutes, I can do a lot of work in 3 minutes. You know, I used to drive, you know, my average, I'll be honest, you know, a lot of psychics have like an average call time of 15 plus, my average is 5 minutes, and you know, we're done and move through a lot of things because I just work that fast. So, you know, 3 minutes, I can get a lot done, and then we can go on and get into a lot of deeper things there, Cimarron. Okay, because you brought up a lot of stuff in chat, and I've been seeing it, but it's stuff that I don't think that, you know, my grandmother used to say, we don't air your dirty laundry. We don't want to be airing your dirty laundry for posterity. Okay,
right. So, yeah, and we've been talking for a good long time. So it's really interesting to talk to you, and we agree on a lot of things, which is good. And even if we disagreed about a lot of things, that would be good too.
Right. Because it's different points of view. And, you know, psychic.world.com, right? Mm-hmm. You can reach us both at, and you're going to be doing some more of these. I think we're looking at maybe doing them, you know, a couple of times a week. So make sure to like, share, and subscribe in the bottom and, you know, share it around. And, you know, remember, new clients get 3 free minutes. And I look forward to talking to you guys, and I'll be on there. And we're moving me into being able to do phone calls there too. So you guys will be able to reach me over the phone too.
So definitely. Yeah. And you brought up a wonderful point. We'll be doing more of these more often with Aeson. I'd like to bring you on for, you know, kind of a couple, maybe once a month or something like that.
I'd love to do once a month. I don't know about once a week. You know, we're going to be launching the radio station soon. And with us launching Psychic World Radio, I will be doing a once a week show there.
Very good. Very good. And so that is going to be kind of the same format, where you might be meeting a few more of Aeson's friends as well. And, you know, kind of working on different things. I mean, today we talked a lot about relationships. That's primarily what we do. You know, every once in a while we get a legal or a career or something like that. But I would say 80 to 90% is going to be.
I'd say 65 for me. Is love and relationships. A large spectrum of my clientele tend to be business. And I don't know why. I've seen that with most male psychics. For some reason, we always get handed the money or the car question, which, you know, I just thank goodness my guide understands what a car is and go, oh, yeah, you know. And I think it's in my feedback or somewhere else. You know, a person called me, asked about a car, and I'm sitting there diagnosing the car. And believe me, I do good to understand what a drive shaft is, but to be describing the in and out gears and all that was amazing to me. But, you know, so I get a lot of financial, I deal with a lot of life changes, career positioning changes, I deal with love and relationships, I deal with company profiles. So, you know, I cover a lot of stuff, you know, and I'll say up front, don't call and ask me grandma's recipe. I don't know, and I can't get her to answer my phone calls on the other side. I'm not a medium. Where I'm in the United States, I have to be careful in a few things. So if I, you know, so you may get told 40 times, I'm not a doctor, go see a doctor, but this is what I think's, you know, going on for the medical side of things that I have dealt with, or the legal side of things. You know, you got to understand, I'm not a paraprofessional. So I have to give disclaimers, but other than that, you know, we're good. You know, I'm here to help and aid my clients and to get them through this, because, you know, we all get out of this the same way, an exit point.
Right.
So I look forward to talking. I love the new projects we're going to be doing with the radio show. Probably we'll do an hour show, and the last 30 minutes of the show will be, you know, readings for you guys to get and, you know, kind of get a flavor for my style. And then, you know, this is going to become a monthly thing with me and her sitting down, and we're going to be talking about everything from, you know, example, you know, next time we may talk about, you know, how, you know, your environment changes how you focus on things. And, you know, so guys, you know, and we've got a lot more readers to bring on, and for you guys to sit and chat with and to get to know, and to interact with. So yeah, you know, enjoy this, enjoy the stream, enjoy and take advantage of it. I mean, cause there's a lot of things, you know, like the Voodoo priest, I'm not sure when he's coming on, or I'm hoping he does come on, because that's a whole different perspective and a whole different energy sector to look at. So it'll be fun. And, you know, I can't wait to watch the journey, because, you know, we're just now starting to pick up and create a lot more positive energy.
Right. And yeah, creating more positive energy. That's what we're here for. And, you know, looking forward to expanding and, you know, just helping people move through it and bring our own flavors into it and our own, you know, personalities, methodologies. And like you said, you know, really kind of helping people understand, no, we can't just diagnose or, you know, give you stock market numbers or whatever. But at the same time, we can help you get a good overview of what's going on.
And a direction of things. And maybe even flip you over to looking at some things that are causing that, because it's a proven fact that if, you know, here's an example. Couples that have problems in relationships, 99.9% of the time, have a lot of crap in their bedrooms. You know, like the TV, the phones, and like piled up clothes and stuff. You know, so that comes up a lot in readings. And, you know, we may give you a different perspective than what you're used to. You know, none of us are script reader psychics or have, you know, I don't have to say, hi, thanks for calling Psychic World. You've reached Aeson. My extension, make sure to write this down, is extension 23574. And yep, I still remember that. So, you know, it's very free flowing, very, you know, very much. And I'm very cut and dry. Snap, snap, get you out of here.
That's exactly how I am too. It's just like most pertinent information. Let's focus on what's the most important things here. We don't have to do all that. Yeah. Let's drag this on for a little while and see how much you can pay me. It's really, you know, kind of most of us are just like, here, let me give you the most value.
Right. And the quickest amount of time. And, you know, and that's what I like too. And that's why I only work with certain networks. You know, the minute they start throwing the dice circle at me or the, oh, you should probably repeat their question before you, no, that's caca. But also, you know, let's talk about that, you know, because, you know, we have a lot of people out there that think that we are going to charge $9.99. You know, the new price is $16.85 that the slave networks are charging. No, I think I'm $2.49 on the network. And who knows, I may go on sale within the next week or so, depending on what my marketing says. But, you know, we're not going to charge exorbitant fees either. And the networks, you know, Psychic World, for the readers, don't charge you exorbitant fees either. You guys are really reasonable in your fees and all that. So, you know, new good readers, come check out Psychic World. New clients, come find us over there. And, you know, tune in here and look for the new updates and new things that we're starting.
Thank you. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yep. And like you said before, if you like this, like us, share us. If you like us, then you're going to get a notice every time we do a new
subscribe. If you subscribe and hit that little notification bell, you're going to get a little thing, and it actually sends it to your phone. It sends you an email saying, hey, we're going to be streaming this week, you know, because we don't have a set schedule right now for YouTube uploads, but we will be doing that more often.
Much more often. Yeah, definitely. And then it always has the archive. So if for some reason you ask us a question, you get taken away for a moment, you know, it happens on Periscope, but then you'll be able to watch the replay as well. Exactly. Or if you want to share it with your friends and family. Yeah, definitely.
Back and read and go back. And I do this a lot with different streams. I'll go back and listen to it again because I know I missed like step three.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
Okay, then. Good night, y'all.
Good night, everybody. And thank you again, Aeson. It was so wonderful to have you here. And again, Aeson Knight, you can find him on Psychic World, amongst other places. Very, you know, he's a master psychic, an energy worker. He does also some, now I'm all like, wait, I read everything that you do. So master psychic, energy worker, ordained minister, you know, all around cool guy, it looks like too. So it's been wonderful talking with you. So
it's been fun.
Yeah. So then we will chat again.
Yep.
And thank you everybody for joining us, for your patience. And we appreciate you. And again, look forward to more of these meetings, radio coming out. Come chat with us too. So like, share, subscribe. We'll talk to you soon. Bye. Have a blessed week. So bye, Aeson.
Bye, honey. You know how to end it, right?
Yep. I see it right here.
Go ahead and end it.